Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome, dear students, in our lecture series on pharmaceutical production technologies. Today, we are going to discuss air handling system. A good air quality is the prerequisite for all pharmaceutical plants. Now, let's discuss how we can ensure and what are these air handling systems. In this particular lecture. Dear students, after completing this module or this lecture, you will be able to understand introduction to HVAC systems, HVAC system types, AHUs, air handling units, components of AHUs, and inspecting the air handling plant. Now let us discuss the HVAC systems first. What does the HVAC mean? Heating, H for heating, V for ventilating, and AC stands for air conditioning. So this comprises HVAC, and it is very commonly used acronym for heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems. HVAC systems reduce the environmental impact of rakes, buildings in several key ways. The most important function of a HVAC system is to provide the rake, building, or that pharmaceutical plant or occupants with healthy and comfortable interior conditions. The air quality is ensured as per the regulatory requirement in pharmaceutical plants with the help of HVAC systems. The primary function of HVAC system is to provide healthy and comfortable interior conditions for occupants. Well-designed, efficient system do this with minimal non-renewable energy and air and water pollutant emissions. By this way, HVAC system helps, and this is utmost important in every pharmaceutical plant. A carefully designed, efficient system can do this with minimal non-renewable energy, as we discussed, and water pollutant emissions to minimize the environmental impact. We have to minimize the environmental impact of whatever the production process is going on in the plant. So HVAC ensures that the environmental is not affected drastically. Cooling equipment that avoids chlorofluorocarbons and hydrochlorofluorocarbons, they are called CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons, CFCs, and hydrofluorocarbons, HVFCs, SCFCs, they eliminate a major cause of damage to the ozone layer. So by this way, HVAC helps in protecting the environmental impact. Overall, they are boon for environment. So we use them to protect the environment for the adverse effect of our processing in any plant. Now, what are the things which HVAC can't do? HVAC cannot clean up the surface of a contaminated place, room, or equipment. Okay. HVAC cannot compensate for workers who do not follow procedures. So it is not going to be a sweeper. It is not going to be a cleaner. Okay. Rest of the things you have to do. the other people have to do. It just provides the system the quality of air, and you will have to ensure the proper functioning of HVAC so that it provides the proper output as desired by the regulatory bodies. What are the types of HVAC systems? Types of system designs. There are several major heating, ventilating, and air conditioning systems types in widespread use today. These are air systems, hydronic and steam systems, and unitary type systems. Most systems in use today fall into one of these categories, or are a combination of or variation of these types. Each type of system has some advantages, some disadvantages. So we must go through before using a particular system that what are their advantages and what are the limitations of that particular system, HVAC system. Air-cooled system, air-cooled chillers. What are their advantages? They have the low installation cost, easily available. No cooling tower or condenser pump are required in these air-cooled chillers. They require less maintenance, and no mechanical room is required for these air-cooled chillers. Water-cooled, sea water-cooled chillers or fresh water-cooled chillers. There may be two types depending on the location of the plant, obviously. What are the advantages of water-cooled chillers? They have got the high efficiency, custom selection in large sizes, large tonnage capability they are having, and indoor chiller location is possible with these chillers, and they have got the longer life as compared to the other chillers. How the monitoring and testing of HVAC clean room is done? First, physical, airborne particulate matter for HEPA, HEPA integrity, high efficiency particulate analyzer, air changes per hour, flow pattern in room, and pressure difference across the filter with respect to the temperature and humidity difference also. So we can monitor these parameters for testing or efficiency, for seeing the efficiency of HVAC clean room. As far as the microbiological parameters are concerned, we can also see these settling plate silt and plate surface sampling we can perform for monitoring and testing of HVAC clean room. Now let's see that what are the frequency, in which frequency these particular parameters are used for monitoring and testing. Particulate monitoring in air is done 6 monthly. HEPA filter integrity testing, that is DOP, dioptile phthalate testing, which we have discussed also in our parental lecture. Yearly test frequency is required. Air changes rate, 6 monthly must be checked. Air pressure differentials must be checked daily. Microbiological monitoring by settle plates, daily it should be done. And temperature and humidity daily, and rather, you know, round the clock monitoring is required for temperature and humidity. HUs, an air handling unit or HU, is a piece of HVAC, heating, ventilating and air conditioning system equipment that is designed to regulate and circulate air throughout a space. Air handlers typically connect to a ductwork ventilation system that distributes the conditioned air throughout the building and return it back to the unit. This we have discussed, the what is called the humidity, what are the various parameters of humidity we have discussed when we were discussing in the drying lecture. We discussed what is the humidity, how a particular piece of humidity can be changed to different piece of air with different humidity, with different temperature and humidity. We discussed, please go through that particular lecture in which we discussed the humidity as such. The capacity of an air handler is most commonly measured by the amount of air it conditions and distributes. This measurement is calculated in volumetric unit known as CFM, cubic feet per minute. This means if you have a space that is 10 by 10 feet, or you can say 1000 cubic feet, and a 500 CFM cubic feet per minute air handler, it would take 2 minutes for the old air in the room to be entirely replaced by fresh conditioned air from the air handler. And you know, this kind of air handlers are also not just the part of this particular pharmaceutical plant. They have got the applicability in each and every place, even when you travel by air. In every aircraft, these air handlers are installed. Now let us discuss, what are the components of air handling unit? Number one, weather lower, silencer, flow rate controller, control damper, okay, and then heating unit, cooling unit or dehumidifier, humidifier and filters. Now as far as the humidifier and dehumidifier is concerned, you can say our refrigerators are also a kind of, or your air conditioners are dehumidifiers or humidifiers, you can say. You might have seen in the AC, your household ACs, your humidification and dehumidification function is also provided. And we have discussed in humidity part that how we can change the quality of an air from one set of humidity to other set of humidity. Now, weather load. To prevent insects, leaves, dirt and rain from entering, this is used. While the silencer is used to reduce noise caused by air circulation. Flow rate control, this is used for automated adjustment of volume of air. Night and day pressure control can be achieved with these. Control damper, they are the fixed adjustment. They can do the fixed adjustment of volume of air. So control dampers are used. So these are the major components of AHUs: weather lower, silencer, flow rate controller and control damper. So please do remember these components, and for detailed study you can go for each and every individual component. Heating unit, if you say another component, it is used obviously to heat the air to the proper temperature when you are, because you require change in temperature as well as humidity. So if you want to bring about the change in temperature, a heater is required. Cooling unit or dehumidifier is required for again the changing the temperature and to cooling the air to the required temperature or to remove the moisture from the air. Now dehumidifier, not only dehumidifier is used for taking up the moisture from the air. It removes the certain moisture from the air to maintain it at a different set of temperature and humidity. Filters, these are used to eliminate particles of predetermined dimensions and microorganisms. While the ducts, these ducts are used for transporting the air. So cooling unit, humidifier, filters and ducts, these are some more components of AHUs. Now what are the major controls in AHUs? Number one, humidity. Obviously first is the humidity control, second is the temperature control and third is the room pressure control. So these are the three controls which must be of good quality if you want to ensure a good quality air in your entire plant. Now temperature control. temperature in the range of 68 to 74 degree Fahrenheit or 19 to 23 degree Celsius range is comfortable for working environment. Temperature control is important in the areas where autoclaves are there, where ovens are there, where dry heat distillation tunnels are there. So temperature may be changed depending upon the presence of some equipments there. Okay, so you will have to set the temperature as well as maybe also the humidity depending on the certain section of a particular plant. Humidity control. Humidifiers, two different types of humidifier can be installed in the air handling units. In both cases, the units are adiabatic humidifiers. Humidity comfort levels are in the 45 to 55% relative humidity RH range. And please do recall how you can calculate the relative humidity by putting the value of dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature in the psychrometric chart. We discussed that how we can do it with the help of psychrometric chart, with the help of dew point determination, various methods we have determined. Please do recall this from our previous lecture. Air dryers can be used to maintain lower than normal humidity levels. Okay, so moving to now, the next parameter is percent relative humidity. Percent RH is the ratio of the partial pressure of water vapor in the air of the vapor pressure of free water at the same temperature. It is also expressed by percent humidity and percent absolute humidity. The ratio of absolute humidity to the saturation humidity at same temperature is called this absolute humidity. So what is the percent absolute humidity? It is the ratio of absolute humidity to the absolute humidity of saturated air at same temperature. For example, what I have shown you here with the example, say for example, you take these two temperatures, say 78 and 161. Can you see it here? That humidities are there. Say for example, we are seeing in the dry bulb temperature 81. It is a dry bulb temperature. We will be letting you know what is a dry bulb and wet bulb temperature. Say for example, there are two temperatures. Say for example, we have got for the 81. 81 is the dry bulb temperature. Okay. So if you take this temperature, it's a simple normal temperature taken at the with the ordinary thermometer. You will take this line upward until it intersects the saturation humidity. Okay, and also the dry bulb temperature you will take, say for example, in this case dry bulb temperature is 67. Okay, this is a 67 as you can see in this graph. You will also take this line upward until it intersects the 100% RH curve. So at point D, what you will do to the nearest parallel and nearest adiabatic cooling line, we are going to let you know what are the cooling line. There are some parallel lines you will draw which will intersect at dry bulb temperature. So this is the point of the humidity of the air. So the ratio of humidity will be seen at this y-axis. So 78 divided by 161. Okay, 78 was the at the temperature, while the 161 at the saturation humidities. So 78 divided by 161 is giving you the percent humidity, that is 48%. So by this way, we can determine the percent relative humidity of a particular piece of air. Next is dry bulb temperature or wet bulb temperature. We were discussing when we are using an air A, say for example, we are using this A air for drying, the difference in vapor pressure between the surface water and the air causes the evaporation. What is happening? That latent heat of evaporation of the water cools the evaporating surface below the air temperature. Now this difference in temperature causes the heat transfer from the air to the liquid at a rate which increases the temperature difference. So while at wet bulb temperature. Now at wet bulb temperature, what is happening? Heat transfer is equal to the heat of vaporization. What is happening actually? That air is whatever the material is there, which is exposed to the air. Actually, it is evaporating, and at the same time, some latent heat of evaporation. When the heat transferred is equal to the heat of vaporization, but it is completely being used for the evaporation, it is the wet bulb temperature and it is constant one. After the initial adjustment of the heat transfer, it becomes constant, and this is the wet bulb temperature. So wet bulb temperature, how we can define it? It is the equilibrium temperature reached by an evaporating surface when the rate of heat transferred to the surface by convection is equal to the rate of heat lost by evaporation. Let us repeat it again. The equilibrium temperature reached by an evaporating surface when the rate of heat transferred to the surface by convection is equal to the rate of heat lost by the evaporation. So what is happening, that from the bulk, the material is being diffused, the heat is being transferred and it is coming to the surface, and then next heat is being used by for the evaporation. So diffusion and the evaporation is coming together. When they are in equilibrium state, then the temperature is called wet bulb temperature. It is measured by means of a thermometer whose bulb is covered by a wick of saturated with water. You just plug in a cotton plug which is impregnated with water, and then whirl it around the air. When the temperature is stabilized, it is wet bulb temperature. While the dry bulb temperature is the actual temperature of the air as measured with the help of an ordinary thermometer. So you can easily determine the dry bulb and wet bulb temperature of a particular air by just using thermometers. Okay. Humidity measurement. Now question is, how we can determine the humidity? There are four major methods: gravimetric method, humidity or psychrometric chart method, dew point method, and hygrometers. Let's see these methods one by one. First is gravimetric method. You might have studied in your plus two standard. What is done in this process? That air is passed through a known weight of a moisture absorbing material like phosphorus pentoxide, and the difference in weight is noted. This is the simplest method. However, this is simple, but it is cumbersome to practice, and the precise humidity can't be measured with the help of this crude method. It is gravimetric method, and it is not used in the pharma industry for routine process. Sling psychrometer method, or humidity or psychrometric chart method. What you are going to do, you will record the dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature. How you will determine? With the help of this sling psychrometer. Can you see? This is the sling psychrometer, or psychrometer they are called. In these two thermometers, it is an ordinary thermometer and a thermometer which is in which you will plug in a saturated wick, or you can say you can plug cotton, plug of impregnated cotton, which is impregnated with water. And you will whirl. It is attached with a hinge which can be rotated. Okay, and this lower hinge can be rotated or whirled around that particular air. And at a particular time, after a certain time, the temperature will be stabilized. So both the temperatures, in the ordinary temperature, the temperature will be dry bulb temperature, while the in the cotton impregnated, that cotton wick having the bulb, that thermometer which is having the cotton wick will show you the wet bulb temperature. So you are having the dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature. With these, you will put these values and you will identify absolute humidity, you will identify percent relative humidity, and you can also identify the dew point. Okay, we have shown you the process in the earlier slide. Do practice the set of conditions by which we can determine the absolute humidity and percent relative humidity of a piece of air with the help of psychrometers. Dew point method. In this method, we can observe the temperature at which the moisture begins to form on a polished cool surface by contact with an air. What we can do? We can reduce, we can put the, we can pass through an air with a polished surface, okay, and the temperature can be lowered, that ice, and the temperature at which the polished surface is showing the dew formation. It is the dew, however, it is tentative one. It is not the precise giving temperature you will get here in the dew point, but yes, it is the easiest method to determine the dew point. And when you are, you have got the dew point, you can also go for the absolute humidity and other terms with the help of other methods also. Okay. Now, hygrometers. They may be mechanical or electrical hygrometers. What we are doing here? We are utilizing any change of any kind of change of mechanical or electrical property with the change in the humidity, and that change is calibrated, and by we can directly see in the calibrated gauge the humidity. These may be the digital humidity meters, and they are very popular in the farm industry for the quick reporting of the humidity for the system, for the plant, or for the unit. After the discussion on the humidity, let us move to panel humidifier. Panel humidifiers are composed of a standardized enclosure including a stainless steel drip pan at the bottom. The enclosure houses the humidifier panel, which has crosswise corrugated channels to ensure minimum air resistance, as well as large contact surface between the air and water, thereby releasing moisture into the circulating air. So this is the function of panel humidifier. The top of the panel contains a water manifold. How it is being done? Let's see. The top of the panel contains a water manifold to which the water is pumped through the pipework from the drip pan by means of a small submersible electrical pump, just like which is there in your coolers, water coolers, simple, which you use in the summer. Water is distributed vertically downwards by gravity, coating the entire inner panel surface with an extremely fine film. As the air flows by the panel horizontally through the spaces provided, turbulent flow conditions are established, thereby resulting in efficient transfer of heat and moisture. So by this way, the panel humidifier works. Now moving to the air scrubber. Air scrubber is composed of an enclosure with a large drip pan at the bottom. The tray contains enough water to create steady state conditions in the scrubber system and is equipped with hoses to connect the circulating pump, supplied when requested with the client. So upon the request of the client, it is supplied, and water supply, drain and overflow fitting. The water travels through a distribution branch with spray nozzles. Two distribution branches may be used to increase the efficiency of the humidifier. Now, what are the air filtration systems? Moving to the next component. Filtration is an important aspect of environmental control in the pharmaceutical industry. The main aim of the filtration is to produce dust-free atmosphere. It is required in areas like spray drying, coating, granulating, milling, packaging, etc. Filters are selected based on the required environment. Now, what is the mechanism of air filtration? Air filtration involves the removal of unwanted particles due to collisions of particles with the filter. Such removal of particles due to collisions are governed by forces called as impingement, diffusion, and interception. So by this way, air is filtered. Now, impingement, it is also called as inertial impaction. This particle inertia causes it to leave the flow streamlines and impact on the fiber. This is called as spraining effect. This is not suitable for particles of certain sizes. The second method is also known as Brownian movement, resulting in the movement of particles from molecular collisions. This is the efficient method for particle sizes. Certain particle sizes we must check with our size ranges requirement. Interception: the particle droplets collides to the one of the filters fiber after coming close enough to it. Oil, metal plates, mesh are used for this, and it affects the particles above 4 microns. These are the three major driving forces for filtration. Air filters are made up of fiberglass, sintered glass, charcoal, glass wool, dry fabric, oil wetting fabric, etc. What are the types of air filters? Ultra low penetration and high efficiency particulate air filter, ULPA and HEPA. So there are two types. HEPA you have heard. One more is there, ultra low penetration, ULPA it is called, ultra low penetration, okay, air filters. High efficiency particulate air filters, packed towers, membrane filter cartridges, and hydrophobic filters. These are four major air filters which are used in the various plants depending on the requirement. HEPA filter. HEPA is an acronym for high efficiency particulate air. This type of air filter can remove at least 99.97% of dust, pollen, mold, bacteria, and any airborne particles with a size of 0.3 micron. Please do remember, I'm again repeating that this type of air filter, HEPA, HEPA filter, can remove at least 99% of dust, pollen, mold, bacteria, and airborne particles with a size of 0.3 micron. In HEPA filter, media is the filtering material, glass fiber, synthetic fiber, non-woven fiber. Sealant is the adhesive material that creates a leak-proof seal between the filter media and the frame. The frame is where the media is inserted, like aluminium, it may be of aluminium, stainless steel, plastic or wood. Face guard. The face guard is a screen attached to the filter to protect the filter media during the handling and installation. Gasket is a rubber or sponge-like material used in to prevent air leaks between the filter and its housing by compressing the compressing them together. So media, sealant, frame, face guard and gasket, these are the major components of HEPA filter. Now let's see construction of HEPA filter. HEPA filter is constructed of borosilicate microfibers in the form of pleated steel, in the form of pleated sheet. Sheet is pleated to increase the overall filtration surface area. The pleats are separated by serrated aluminium baffles or stitched fabric ribbons, which direct airflow through the filter. This combination of pleated sheets and baffles acts as filtration medium. Okay, first thing was medium. HEPA filter is installed into an outer frame made of fire rated particle board, aluminium or stainless steel. The frame media junction are permanently glued or pot sealed to ensure a leak proof. So leak proofing is done. HEPA filter performance is dependent on the following characteristics. Number one, airflow. Number two, temperature. Then pollutant loading, dust holding capacity, filter media, construction of HEPA, operating condition, etc. So these are the major performance governing factors for HEPA filters. PAC towers. These are custom designed to provide removal efficiency in the range of 95% to 99% for acid and toxic gases with a low pressure drop. Now, membrane filter cartridges. These are compact, easily handled, and can be manufactured as fully disposable form. These are available as either pre-filter, particulate and liquid aerosol, or sterilized filter like bacterial contaminants types. Okay. The hydrophobic filters, these are generally used as vent filters. They protect the contents of the containers against contamination in the air which enters or leaves them. Now moving to the dust collectors. Now we are talking in terms of complete air handling unit, okay? So taking one by one these things, so that's why now it is the turn of dust collector. Dust collectors are used for equipment maintenance. Air pollution is controlled and with the dust collectors. Main features include low cost and maintenance. They are most commonly used for all type of medium from coarse to fine. However, the exception may be there. Now, what are the types of dust collectors? Dry mechanical collectors, wet collectors, and scrubbers, fabric collectors, and ESP. What are the dry mechanical collectors? These are dry centrifugal collectors, and their collection efficiency is influenced by size, shape, weight of the particle, concentration of dust, and inlet velocity types. There may be gravity separators, inertial separators, cyclone collectors, and high efficiency centrifugal collectors. So these are some types of collectors. Now, wet collectors. Wet collectors operates on the collection mechanism in which they collect the droplets, the contact particles with water or another liquid. What are the advantages of the wet collectors? They can handle high temperature and moisture, dust which represent explosion or fire hazard in the dry room can be wetted and collected with the help of these wet collectors. So what are the types of these wet collectors? Spray dryer, PAC towers, wet centrifugal collectors, and wet dynamic precipitator, Venturi type, and Orifice type. Now, fabric collectors works on the mechanisms of impaction, interception, and diffusion, and or diffusion. The advantages of the fabric collectors include they can handle the varying exhaust gas flow rates and particle loading. The fabric collectors, in the fabric collectors, the amount of filter area depends on number one, release of characteristic of the dust, porosity of dust cake, concentration of dust in carrier gas stream, types of fabric and surface, airflow pattern within the collector, temperature and humidity within the gas stream. So by this way we can see that which kind of fabric collector you should choose and what are the governing factors. Depending on these factors, we can have a close monitoring on entire HVAC system. Now ESP, electrostatic precipitators. They works on the mechanism of ionizing the gas, charging the dust particles, transporting the particles to the collecting tubes, then neutralizing the dust particles, and then removing the dust from the collecting surface. So they ionize the gas, generate the charge in the dust particles, then transport the particles to the collecting tube, neutralize the dust particles, and then remove the dust from the collecting surface. So this is the mechanism of ESP, electrostatic precipitators. Now, what are the types of ESP? Contrail or single stage, pannier two stage. So they may be single stage or two stage. Single stage is also called Cottrell. The Cottrell combines ionization and collection in a single stage. While the two stage one works on ionization and collection in different stages, and it has got the advantages that they can handle the large gas volumes and high collection efficiency for small particles can be achieved with the help of these ESPs. But the limitations are that they are quite costly methods. So cost effective, they are cost effectiveness is the problem associated with the ESPs. They are very costly. Now moving to these silencers. The baffles of the silencer sections are constructed of natural galvanized steel sheet with a peak at the air inlet end to decrease the head loss. The baffles are also filled with a sound insulating material composed of fiberglass with an appropriate density. This material is also heat resistant and its outer face is protected against the air erosion. So this was about the silencers. There are two options for silencers, PA and PAM. The sound insulation is protected against erosion due to airflow by flame retardant protective layer, and this is the most common approach in ventilation and air conditioning system. While in the second type, similar to PA, but with an additional polyester film coating like Melinex used for applications with acidic, alkaline or oily gases, as it can be steam cleaned. It can clean with the help of steam. So there are two types, PA and PM. Now moving to the inspecting the air handling plant, how we can inspect the, what should be done. Let's have an overview. Let's have a gross overview that first is verification of design documentation, including description of installation and functions, specifications of requirements, operating procedures, maintenance instructions, maintenance records, training logs, environmental records, and walking around the plant. So these are the major things. However, in the regulatory requirements, various regulatory bodies provide a detailed instructions for following the maintenance of a good quality air in the entire plant. So we must go through the regulatory requirements with respect to the GMP, you can say good manufacturing practices, and the requirement of the air for that particular plant. Okay, because the requirement of air for a parenteral plant may be differing from a plant which is handling the solid dosage form like tablet capsules or the liquid dosage form. Okay, so we cannot generalize each and everything in every plant. So friends, these are some of the further readings for you. Please go through these further readings and see what more you can learn with respect to the HVAC system or the air handling system. After going through this lecture, let me summarize whatever we have learned. We learned what does HVAC mean. HVAC is heating, ventilation and air conditioning system. What are the HVAC system types? We studied all the types. Then we studied air handling units, their types, limitations, advantages. We studied the components of AHUs, that what are the components of AHUs. We must go through, and depending on the requirement of the plant, depending on the product, and depending on the regulatory guidelines, we must choose a suitable component for air handling unit. And the inspection of air handling plant or air handling systems must be inspected as per the requirement of the entire production process, or depending upon the nature of product or which you are producing in that particular plant, or the nature of process which you are following in that particular plant. And the entire process must be in compliance with the concerned regulatory requirement. So I request you to go through the GMP guidelines, good manufacturing practices, in which the air handling systems are also, air handling requirements are also described and prescribed by the various regulatory bodies. Okay, so please go through, these are freely available in the internet, these guidelines. Please go through, and especially when you are working in a pharmaceutical plant, you must be having some practical experience. Please include this, that practical experience, with the standard protocols of air handling, and ensure the good quality air. With the same time, you must not forget to protect the environment. And this entire air handling has the aim to protect the environment from the hazardous pollutant and emissions from the plant. So best of luck for your further readings. Hope you have got a good insight of air handling units. However, it needs elaboration of each and every type. It's a complete science, complete engineering subject. So please go through the further readings which we have prescribed to you. And thanks for attending our lectures. Happy learning!